Game On is brought to you by
Winning has never been this simple. Bet with 1xBet.
Game On. It's Game On. We are big on sports. Big on sports.
All right, welcome back. Definitely a big conversation on the show a little later on, the sacking of Unai Emery. Feel free to ask now what you think of that particular there. But quickly, we shall be talking the big one, the Battle of Kampala, KCCA up against AC Villa today at exactly 4 p.m. But before we get into that particular conversation and the Uganda Cranes as well, first things first, let's start off with a bit of boxing. Because like I mentioned at the beginning of the show, later on today at exactly 7 p.m., all roads will be leading into the IUEA Auditorium down in Kansanga as our very own Shafik Chiwanuka of Uganda battles it out with Dube Tamsanga from Zimbabwe as they'll be contesting the WBF Africa heavyweight title in what promises to be the cracker of a boxing bout. All right, guys, quick substitution on the show. Hope is here. Definitely Nick as well. How are you doing, guys?
Been catching the leftovers of what is now left of Unai Emery just on Sky a few minutes back, and it's quite the scene, because just when you thought that Christmas came early for Arsenal, there is one little situation that is left to be solved. That is, who does get to replace him, because even the sacking of Unai Emery won't entirely solve the problem. It's only just a step in, you know, a step being taken by the hierarchy at Arsenal that they want to see progress. But that being said, not too bad. Tonight is a very special night for one man, that is Shafik Chiwanuka. The other beast being in Tamsanga Dube will be out there trying to frustrate him. But hopefully tonight will be one special night that he will forever remember.
Third professional bout for him. What should we be expecting ahead of this one here?
Looking
at me now. No, it's yours.
It's yours. What do you expect?
I think it's going to be a very interesting fight for Shafik. Everyone has been looking towards the fight. And for me, leave alone the pressure, leave alone the platform itself, I'm sure he has been training a lot. Boxing is always about money, but people have invested a lot in him, and you expect massive crowds to turn up for this fight. And for me, one thing is that when you have media and, you know, so many media houses covering the sport, that clearly shows that he's a big man in Uganda. Everyone should be waiting for this big fight.
Okay, Nick, he came out saying in the press conference, Ebisovi Sala, meaning that he's ready to cut through Dube Tamsanga. We know Dube is a more experienced fighter, 15 bouts, 12 wins in there. This is only the third fight for Shafik Chiwanuka. Does the inexperience come in?
I guess it does. It will kick in eventually, because we're all just waiting to see, can, you know, Shafik last one, two, three rounds? Because from what we've been seeing initially, he's, you know, managed to see out his opponents inside a minute. And that for me will be his big test, because I don't think Tamsanga Dube flew all the way from Zimbabwe to be knocked out inside a minute. I'm pretty sure he's read a bit about who Shafik Chiwanuka is. When he mentions Ebisovi Sala, I think in a way he has every right to say what he wants to say all the time, because boxers are known for being mouthy. But for Shafik Chiwanuka, he's got to know this man stands more ground than he does or than he has. Going into this bout, all the odds are against him, better than Shafik Chiwanuka. A few other small nitty-gritties will fall in place, like the fans rooting for him, like the atmosphere, you know, the height as well, because he has a much bigger height compared to Tamsanga. That being said, for me, I worry for Shafik. Why? Because of all of these things we keep talking about, experience, but not forgetting that boxing can be very, very interesting. You can have six, seven flat rounds, and then one moment stands out for you, and then eventually you're the winner. But for Shafik Chiwanuka, I do believe that he will come out quite strong. How he does it, his techniques will actually do him good. I don't want the crowd, I don't want the situation or the moment to get to him, because sometimes you get carried away, the fans are rooting for you, then one bad moment, and that's a KO, and you're good and done. But that being said, of course, for me, tonight is a very special night for him, because having just done two bouts, and then you have a title shot, that for me is a huge, huge plus in regards to his boxing career. How he decides to deal or approach the bout today is entirely up to him. We're just looking out for a win, hoping that he comes out, not inside a minute, but hopefully maybe six or seven rounds.
All right, definitely dubbed the fight of the year at the IUEA Auditorium. But tonight, let's all come out in big numbers and get cheer on everyone. That is Shafik Chiwanuka, and hopefully the WBF Africa heavyweight title stays right here in Uganda. But quickly, I'm from boxing now. Let's talk a bit of basketball, because tonight, game two, both for the men and the women, when it comes to the National Basketball League playoff finals, the UCU Lady Canons did win game one closely contested, ultimately edging it 71-69. And then for the men, the City Oilers will be out there to pick up a win after losing game one against the UCU Cannons. That was 59-67. A big game, City Oilers, can they redeem themselves tonight?
Well, that's a big question to ask, to be honest. I watched them on Wednesday. Mm. I think that was the weakest team because they had only 8 players. And I remember the first quarter and maybe half of the second quarter, they didn't change any of the players. And that case shows that they still have a lot to do. And coming up against the UCU Cannon side that looks to be more energetic, and I think they have something to aim for, especially coming for the second round. They have the advantage, and they have proved it the whole season. I remember last time when we were talking about City Oilers and UCU before the game, we talked about how UCU have proved that they can sit on the table of men, and they've clearly showed it from the regular season to, you know, playoffs and the best of sevens, the first game.
Yeah.
And that clearly shows that they are going to put, you know, push City Oilers to the edge. And for me, the players themselves, that cohesion I saw in the team, even when, you know, Oilers have this tendency, when they're playing a better side that clearly is pushing them to the wall, they tend to stay in the game. But Warriors had to make sure that City Oilers were completely out of the game. And for me, that's the most important thing. They have, the coach knows how to play around with most of the players' abilities. If they come into this one, I don't think UC Cannons is going to, you know, take that lead.
Nick, redemption time for both the JKL Dolphins and City Oilers.
I feel like, you know, Cannons can right now ride on what they achieved in game one. You know, they would fancy a win tonight the same way they pulled it off in game one. Could be the same way they could pull it off in game two. I'm not riding off Oilers because we know them for a very slow start. Eventually, they tend to pick up. Going up against a very good side. Why? Because they've been consistent right from regular season going into the playoffs. The manner in which they managed, you know, to dispatch a power is quite, for me, a statement. Going into game two tonight, you know, one thing will be clear. Oilers will come all out to level the series at 1-1. Though the name in David Kongor Deng didn't turn up in game one, I think he had about 4 points, having played 20 minutes of basketball. I want to think it was not an injury. It was just a bad in office. That being said, your big names will show up or need to show up to have you in the game. And tonight, names like James O'Kelly had a game high of about 17 points. In that regard, talk about the youngsters like Tony Dreleba, Josh Johnson,
Ivan
Mwezi as well, Indukumana Landry. Time and again, has been a match winner. Those for me will be key names for the side in Oilers to actually come out. Not to forget on the opposite side, Titus. We have Deng himself. We've got Fadili Chuma, the captain, among others. So it's going to be very, very evenly contested affair. For the JKL, for the Lady Dolphins, I think they're very much still in the game. I think let's not read so much into game one. It's the best of seven. It's still a whole long journey. It's going to be questions asked of them if they lose tonight, and they'll be behind by 2-0.
All right, Saturday, 6:30 p.m. is kickoff for the women's game. The UC Lady Cannons up against the JKL Lady Dolphins. And then at 8:30 p.m., the City Oilers up against the UC Cannons of Coach Nick Natuheris. So let's go out there and watch some basketball as well. But quickly, I'm from basketball now. Let's talk the starter in Uganda Premier League, because action returns this particular afternoon. Kickoff is 4 p.m. And we should have confirmation of the table standings and the fixtures as well on your screens in just a bit. But the big game is the battle for Kampala KCCA up against AC Villa, the two most successful sides when it comes to football in Uganda. Clearly, it doesn't get any bigger than that.
It doesn't. And for me, it's perfect time, really, for KCCA to be taking on AC Villa. AC Villa at the moment are performing well. Well, the other side for KCCA, they've been inconsistent, losing games where they're not supposed to be losing. Look at their previous game against Mbara City, you know, down in Kacheka. And for me, now I can confirm that KCCA is now a bogey team for Mbara City, because I thought, leave alone Mike Mutebi, not on the touchline, missing the game, not traveling with the team. And then the result itself, how Mbara City overturned the tables and won that game. That clearly shows there's something, because he still has some weaknesses and flaws in the team. If Mike Mutebi can, because we all know he knows how to play around with his team, you know, tinker with his squad and get the results. Most of these players have been on and off. Some of the players, some went to the Uganda Cranes. Remember that game that was played with Vipers, you know, prior to the game for the Uganda Cranes. And then now you have Sekafa, where most of the KCCA players have been summoned to the team.
They are first with the team, then they will join.
They will join. But it clearly shows that there's still something lacking in the KCCA team. Well, leave alone the players who departed during the summer. And now you have players who came in, the young lads. They've been trying to perform, but you can feel there's too much pressure, because we all know KCCA is winning. champions. They had 4 games in hand where you think they would close the gap between them and Vipers, but now it looks to be a different story. And now you have AC Villa, who are on a big run, a good run of form, and they're coming to Star Times. Trust me, this is one of the games that, you know, will keep fans on their toes.
Nick, traditional Giants, big game?
Yeah, well, in a way, I mean, the last 2 seasons, AC Villa was a sleeping giant. Up until this season, to see what Kaziba and his technical team have built, I mean, 7 wins, that for me is quite very huge.
One
for
loss.
A club that was struggling for the last 2 seasons. We've seen a series of managers come and go, the Shafiq bosses of this world, the Wasso bosses of this world, the Bamanas of this world. Putting that aside, I think we've got to respect what Villa have achieved this season, especially in this first half. Going into this game, for KCFC, it's desperate time. Why? Because they lost during midweek against Mbara City. They'll be desperate, hoping to recover from that slim defeat against Mbara City. The conversation was they had 4 games in hand. How much have they fed off that? It's always deadly, you know, to have games in hand, knowing that you're chasing for the other, you know, you're chasing for the title. But for Mike Mutebi, yes, it's been a very ugly, sad week for him, missing the game against Mbara City. During the presser, he was late again, apologizing. KCC right now are in a very bad place. And you want to think that Villa can actually feed off that going into this game. Can there be an upset? I think there can be. So it should be a very interesting game of football.
All right, Saturday kickoff is 4 p.m. down in Lugogo at the Star Times. Both teams separated by just a single point. AC Villa is currently third on 27 points. KCC is fourth on 26. And quickly, a win for KCC, I could see them moving as high as second. But Vipers there is top on 34 points. They are 5 points ahead of second place Ball. AC Villa is third on 27, a point ahead of fourth place KCC. Onduparaka is down in fifth. You've got URA in sixth place there, and then Wakiso Giants and Maroons seventh and eighth respectively. Meanwhile, on the bottom half, you've got Mbara City with 19 points. Just a point ahead of Busoga United and Express, who sit 10th and 11th respectively. Chetume is in 12th place with 16 points. Toro United just outside the relegation zone on 14. And then you've got Police, Bright Stars, and the club side that is Proline, who are bottom of the league standings there. So that is quick confirmation of the Star Times Uganda Premier League. But quickly, from that, let's talk a bit of national team football. The Crested Cranes, that is the under-17 team, alongside the Uganda Cranes, are getting ready for the SEKAFA Senior Challenge Cup. Kicks off on the 9th of December. We'll be running all the way up until the 19th of December as well. Big games, Jonathan McKinstry in there for the Uganda Cranes, and then Ayubo Khalifa for the under-17.
I don't want to be so excited about the SEKAFA, because I think the Uganda Cranes have made it such a habit to win the SEKAFA. There isn't much to say. We're looking forward to it. I think right now the excitement should be qualifying again for the AFCON and see how well we get to do in the forthcoming FIFA World Cup. Yes, that's for a later stage, but right now the focus is on the SEKAFA. I think it's going to give McKinstry an opportunity for him to learn more from the local players and kind of create a relationship between him and them. That being said, hopefully for them they can win the competition. The same goes for Bodega and Company, having seen how, not dreadful, but how disappointed they were in Arusha. I hope that doesn't get to be carried with the under-17, because I mean the success they've had in a space of what, 6-7 months after the COSAFA outing, I think they would want to build on that. But McKinstry and Company should have enough armory, enough quality to actually see how the SEKAFA in my title.
30-man squad for Jonathan McKinstry, including a 16-year-old goalkeeper, that is Giacomo Cage, but ultimately a squad made up of only the locally based players.
And I think for me that's the most important thing. You want to give him a hard time, you know, that he has to take enough time to learn how players, because these are players who are playing in the same league, it would be easy for him to understand. But for me, talking about what Nick said, this shouldn't be an excitement, but it should be a big task for McKinstry, because yes, before we look at the African Cup of Nations, the World Cup qualifiers, we have to know this should be the, you know, building a team that he wants and knowing what the kind of team that he's going to, you know, help him prepare for such the big tournaments, because he would want to win this and prove to Uganda, to the fans or Uganda at large, that he's up to, you know, Natasha, and he can do for us a job. For the ladies, I think for Farid Gabriega, it's a big opportunity for him, for the ladies to be back, you know, into playing, because they've been so busy from COSAFA, then to the concluded tournaments where they were the third. You know, the they came up against big sides, Tanzania and Kenya, you knew they would fall apart because they didn't have enough training, and the fringes themselves also could not allow them to do the job. But it's good that now the players have been playing together for a long time, they understand each other. So that chemistry itself should help her and the whole team to proceed and see what they can get out of that tournament.
All right, finally from the domestic scene, the FUFA drum competition also returns this weekend. Games will be spread across Gulu and Lira in there as well. You've got teams like Toro in action. You've got the likes of Acholi in action. You've got teams like, Buganda, the reigning champions, Busoga, among so many others in there as well. The quarterfinals of the FUFA drum upon us.
Yeah, it's a big game. I mean, for us, I remember last season it was one of the big talking points, the FUFA drum. And coming back now, Lila and Guru hosting the quarterfinals, one thing that we should be expecting, the massive crowd that should be turning up. And I think for me, it's one of the things fans have been promoting, you know, this tournament. It's a good thing, and that's what we want. Most of the talent should be coming in such, you know, communities and games. And for me, it's a good thing for Uganda, Ugandan football at large, and for the fans. It's something we should be looking forward to.
All right, maybe the numbers as well. We'll talk about the numbers. You know, the last, I think, in the group stages, there was, I think, Langwen, who Ankole, I think, actually one of the two. And they initially said that it was 3,000 entrants, and I think the price went ahead by 1,000 shillings. But because they knew the traffic would be so big, they'd say it's, you know, hiking the price by 1,000 shillings. No, they don't come, didn't work because the fences were broken down. Eventually, the, you know, get collection was no more. But looking forward to a very, very massive crowd this weekend.
All right, guys, let's quickly switch gears now away from the domestic scene. Let's talk football across Europe, because last night the Europa League was on as well. Big results. But for Unai Emery, things went from bad to worse as his boys, that is Arsenal at the Emirates, lost by 2-1 against a German opposition in Frankfurt. A result that ultimately saw him getting the sack earlier today. Arsenal last night losing that particular game, Unai Emery is now out.
Well, we start with the game last night. We saw how Arsenal started well in that game. Emerick Aubameyang opened his score in the second half. Frankfurt grew confidence, they grew in character, and eventually it paid off. A 2-1 victory thanks to the breath from Diachi, Kamada on 55 and 64 minutes respectively. I guess the hierarchy sat down and finally, in nearly 25 years, sat down and listened to the noises made by the Arsenal faithful fan, not just at the Emirates, but also across the world, because I think we've seen how frustrating it has been. Even before Unai Emery came in place, the man before him was Arsene Wenger. The legacy he built and the way he left, for me, was just a statement that Arsenal players, rather Arsenal fans, are hungry for more success. I mean, ask yourself this $1 million question. When was the last time Arsenal lifted a major title besides the three EPL titles back with Arsene Wenger? That being said, for me, it was the frustration that grew among us, the Arsenal fans. We've seen how they've been trying to boycott fixtures. Look at how empty the seats are yesterday. That was just a statement that Arsenal fans are frustrated and they're literally just, you know, they've had enough. So the question, the decision made by the Arsenal hierarchy, you know, to let go of that senior in Unai Emery was not something so hard because of the current form. 7 games without a win. That for me is ridiculous for a club, say, like Arsenal, who are ambitious, seemingly, and want to compete and match the likes of Man City, Liverpool, and Chelsea. And for Unai Emery, I feel for him as an Arsenal follower. But that being said, the hierarchy at Arsenal have got to take this club quite seriously, because then without the fans, there is no Arsenal.
Hope, 18 months in charge, not that much for him to show for the team in there. Ultimately, he gets the sack. 3 wins in the Premier League the entire campaign. And clearly, by the look of things, Lundberg now has a lot to do for this team.
I think for me, to be honest, it took long for Unai Emery to be sacked. He should have been sacked before Mauricio Pochettino, because he was doing worse. But anyway, these are two different clubs, you know, have their own way of doing things. But one thing I know about Unai Emery, yes, he has been losing games. But the worst part is because they spent a lot of money doing the transfer. It was the first time we were seeing Arsenal in 3 years where they are spending so much money on a player, and that was Pepe. You bought in Tierney, you worked on the defense, the midfield, you have Ozib, you still have one of your best players in the previous season, that was Torreira, and then he was being benched. Players lost confidence, he lost games that he was not supposed to be losing, and that clearly for me, there was no way Arsenal fans were going to rally behind him and give him the support that he deserves. Going forward, the new manager has a big task ahead of him, new pressure, and the fans will be expecting a lot, because Arsenal is all about, as a big club, everyone expects you to be winning, even games that you don't expect to lose. So that's a big task ahead of him. And for the games coming up, he's still in Europa League. They have a chance they could fight the next round. And he should be looking forward to that and then see what he can do the rest of the season.
I think you've got to break it down. One, there were statements like, nowhere to hide, no formation. Mm-hmm. We questioned playing from the back. I think that's been the worst Arsenal format ever. Yeah. They've really sucked at it. They tried it and it failed. And I think for me, in a way, if something you know is tried and it doesn't work for you, step away from it. We also questioned the beat of Mason Ozil, yeah. Why snubbing out with the most paid and most, should I say, with quality? Why fall out with your top players? Team selection was always a problem as well because time and again you have your three best attacking players, Pepe, Laka, and Uba. Mm-hmm. Why bench one of them? So a few areas that he failed to perfect. And that being said, you have so many Arsenal legends coming in saying and giving their opinion. It's their right to say their opinion. But on the other hand, Arsenal fans growing with so much rage and hate for the man in Unai Emery. Even for Arsene Wenger as well. Mm-hmm. He never left on a very, very good page. But for Unai Emery to walk out after 18 months, clearly says that Arsenal hierarchy want to change.
Quickly, as we wrap it up, possible replacements for him, plenty of names.
Plenty of names, of obviously being Mauricio Pochettino being the main man, or should I say the guy who is favorite take on the job. Nuno Espirito as well has been pipelined. I don't want to believe that he is the rightful man for this job. Mm. You want to look at a man with a prolific fat CV, a Mauricio, a Jose Mourinho type kind of, a Carlo Ancelotti type kind of, but it's going to take Arsenal some while before they get one man to replace Unai Emery. For now, I think Freddie and company need to kind of try to work with what they have, listen more to the fans, because the fans have some very fine ideas that can actually help the team grow.
All right, Manchester United, a very young squad that, Ole Gunnar Solskjaer had away in Kazakhstan. They lost by 2-1 in their game last night. But quickly, let's have a look at some of the fixtures that you should be looking out for this particular weekend. As action does get to return, there should be plenty of games, and definitely including Chelsea, who will be at home against West Ham in there. But as those fixtures get onto your screens, certainly as before we get wrap up the show. All right, the early kickoff is at the St. James's Park. Newcastle do host Manchester City. Burnley at the Turf Moor will be welcoming Crystal Palace. Chelsea in the London Derby will be up against West Ham. Liverpool at the Anfield will be hosting Brighton. Tottenham for Mourinho Game 3, he'll be up against Bournemouth. Southampton at the St. Mary's will be hosting Watford. And then on Sunday, the first game for the interim, Freddie Ljungberg will be at the Carrow Road, where Norwich City will be up against Arsenal. And definitely action continues. And, on Sunday as well, Wolves will be hosting Sheffield United. Leicester City, who look to be on fire, I'll be up against Everton. And then Manchester United will wrap it up at the Old Trafford as they do take on Aston Villa. All right, guys, that certainly does bring us to the end of the show. A big thank you to everyone that has been watching out there. We've been probably powered by OneXBet. And do remember, tonight, all roads lead to Kansanga, IUEA Auditorium. Let's all come out in big numbers. Let's get support Shafiq Chuanuka as he looks to retain the WBF Africa heavyweight title. But for now, that's a wrap.
Game on. It's game on. We are big on sports. Big on sports.
Game on. It's brought to you by...
Winning has never been this simple. Bet with 1xBet.